Hey guys, this is Vyom Joshi with Superior North. Welcome back to my channel. Today we will be talking about a stock that I came across while going through the Japan Company Handbook. That stock is Shin-Etsu. Shin-Etsu is the world's largest maker of PVCs and semiconductor silicon wafers. Today we'll review the company's annual report to get a better idea of its business segments. Then we'll look at the company's fundamentals by reviewing the key ratios. We'll perform a discounted free cash flow DCF analysis to find the intrinsic value of the company. And finally, do an expected rate of return calculation to see if you were to invest in Shin-Etsu at the current stock price, what kind of return could we expect on this investment? So let's dive in and review Shin-Etsu.
Hey guys, let's start off by looking at Shin-Etsu's annual report for the year 2021. On page 8 of this report, the company talks about its business model. It shows how it has 6 operating segments, and we will be reviewing these 6 segments here in a little bit. On the next page, the company compares the value created over the past 10 years. The net sales grew from about 1 trillion yen in 2010 to about 1.5 trillion yen in 2020. The operating income grew from about 149 billion yen to about 392 billion yen. The return on invested capital was about 9.7% in 2010 and is about 17.2% in 2020. The return on equity was about 7% in 2010 and is about 10.7% in 2020. Cash dividends grew from about 100 yen in 2010 to about 250 yen in 2020. Next, we can see that the market capitalization grew from about 1.78 trillion yen in 2011 to about 7.75 trillion yen in 2021. This is about a 4.5 times increase. What this means is if you had invested $100 in Shin-Etsu in 2011, by now that investment would have grown to about $450. Next, we can see that the company has a high grade rating. When it comes to patents, the company acquired about 1,842 patents and has held about 21,222 patents. When it comes to market share, the company has a global rank of number 1 in the PVC, semiconductor silicone, and pheromone formulations division. In the silicone derivatives, the company is globally ranked number 2, and in Japan, it's ranked number 1. And finally, in silicones, its global ranking is number 4, and Japan rank is number 1. Finally, its composition ratios of overseas sales is about 74%. What this means is every $100 that the company makes in sales, $74 out of those $100 are made from sales overseas. Next, on page 30 of this report, the company further talks about its business segments. Shin-Etsu's first business segment is its PVC chloralkali business. Over here, the company states that the polyvinyl chloride, also known as PVC, resins are general-purpose resins used in a wide range of applications from everyday products to all kinds of industrial materials. With 3 production bases in the US, Europe, and Japan, the Shin-Etsu group has a capacity to produce 4.15 million tons of PVC resins each year. On the next page, the company provides us applications and uses of its PVC and caustic soda. PVC is used in PVC pipes, plastic greenhouse for agriculture, electric wire coating material, PVC framed windows, and sliding materials. Next, the caustic soda is used in alumina, paper and pulp, cathode material for lithium-ion batteries, and superabsorbent polymers. The second business segment is its semiconductor silicone business. Over here, the company claims that the Shin-Etsu Group is world's leading manufacturer of silicone wafers used as substrates for semiconductor devices. On the next page, the company provides us the application of its products. Products are used in communication computers such as data centers, personal computers, and smartphones, automobiles such as electric vehicles, hybrid cars, and car navigation systems. In the consumer market, it's used in televisions, game devices, smartwatches, digital cameras, and so forth. And there are also other applications in industries, bullet trains, ATMs, and vending machines. The third business segment is its silicones business. Over here, the company states that silicone is a highly functional material that has both organic and inorganic characteristics and many superior features. The group has developed more than 5,000 silicone products that are used in a wide range of industries, including electronics and electronic applications, automobiles, construction, cosmetics, healthcare, and food. On the next page, the company provides us applications of its silicone products. The products are used in cosmetics, lithium-ion batteries, contact lenses, CPAP devices, fuel-efficient tires, buildings, plastic products, textile treatments, ship bottom paints, and toys. The fourth business segment is Shin-Etsu's electronics and functional materials business. In this business segment, the company supplies rare earth magnets, which are essential for reducing the size and weight of motors used in a variety of devices, including hybrid cars, electric vehicles, industrial applications, and home applications. Additionally, this segment also provides various materials that are used in semiconductor manufacturing process. On the next page, the company provides us the major applications of its rare earth magnets, which are used in industrial robots, energy-saving air conditioners, hard disk drives, and offshore wind generation units. The company also shows how it provides the raw materials needed for semiconductor production. The fifth business segment is its specialty chemicals business. This business segment includes the cellulose derivatives, which are environmentally friendly materials made from natural polymer cellulose, which are a core product of the specialty chemicals business. The application of cellulose derivatives are versatile and used in fields such as pharmaceuticals and food to materials for construction and civil engineering work, coatings, ceramics, and toiletries. Shin-Etsu claims that it has the world's largest share of cellulose derivatives in Japan and meets the global needs as the world's foremost manufacturer with bases in Japan, Europe, and the United States. On the next page, the company provides us the major products and applications of this segment, which include cellulose derivatives, silicon metal, synthetic pheromones, polyvinyl alcohol, aroma chemicals, and solvent. The sixth and last business segment is its process trading and specialized services business. This business segment consists of the Shin-Etsu Polymer Company Limited, which develops and supplies products that are easy to use and highly functional products making use of materials processing technologies. This business segment also includes the Shin-Etsu Engineering Company Limited, which is involved mainly in the design and construction of groups' manufacturing plants, and its engineering technologies have strong reputation with customers outside of the group. Major products and applications in the Shin-Etsu Polymer Company Limited include input devices, wafer cases, silicon catheters, and so forth. The Shin-Etsu Engineering Company Limited includes the engineering and vacuum assembly equipment. Now that we have a brief understanding of the six operating segments, let's review the revenue breakdown across those segments. All the numbers here are in thousands of US dollars. We can see that in the year 2021, the PVC segment brought in about $4.3 billion in sales. The silicone segment brought in about $1.9 billion. The specialty chemicals brought in about $1.2 billion. The semiconductor silicone brought in about $3.4 billion. The electronics and functional materials brought in about $2.2 billion. And finally, the processing, trading, and specialized services brought in about $2 billion. Overall, for the year 2021, the total sales amounted to about $13.5 billion. Next, looking at the operating income. The operating income is what we get when we subtract the cost of goods and operating expenses from that segment's sales. The ratio of the operating income to the sales is also known as the operating margin. So it gives us an idea of how much money is left with the company once it has paid for the cost of goods and operating expenses. The operating margin is about 20% for the PVC segment, about 21% for the silicone segment, about 16% for the specialty chemicals segment, about 38.5% for the semiconductor silicone segment, about 29% for the electronics and functional materials segment, and finally about 6% for the processing, trading, and specialized services segment. So overall, even though the PVC segment brings in the most amount of sales across all the segments, it is actually the semiconductor silicone segment that is the most profitable, as about 38.5% of this segment's sales gets translated into its operating income. On the next page, the company breaks down its revenue across its geographic areas. In the year 2021, about $3.5 billion came from Japan, about $3 billion came from the United States, $1.4 billion came from China, $3.3 billion came from Asia, $1.4 billion came from Europe, and about $892 million came from other places. When it comes to plant, property, and equipment, the company has about $3.4 billion of assets in Japan, $5.3 billion of assets in the United States, and about $1.8 billion of assets in other places. Now that we have a brief understanding of Shin-Etsu's business model, its six operating segments, and the revenue breakdown across those segments, let's review the company's fundamentals by focusing on its key ratios. Hey guys, now let's review Shin-Etsu's key ratios. I'm on Morningstar looking at Shin-Etsu Chemical Company Limited, ADR. Under key ratios, I have the financials. The first item on the list is the revenue. The revenue is the top line of the income statement. This is the amount of money that comes in via sales. Back in 2012, the company's revenue was about 1 trillion yen. And for fiscal 2021, it was about 1.5 trillion yen. Over the past 10 years, the company's revenue has slowly been trending upwards. Next, looking at the operating income. The operating income is what's left with the company once we subtract the cost of goods and operating expenses from the company's revenue. Back in 2012, the company's operating income was about 150 billion yen, and for the year 2021, it was about 392 billion yen. Similar to the company's revenue, the operating income over the past 10 years has been trending upwards. Next, looking at the net income. The net income is the bottom line of the income statement. This is the amount of money that's left with the company once it has paid for the cost of goods, operating expenses, non-operating expenses, interest on its debt obligations, and taxes. Back in 2012, the company's net income was about 100 billion yen. And for the year 2021, it was about 294 billion yen. Similar to the trend that we saw with the company's revenue and operating income, the company's net income over the past 10 years has also been trending upwards. We can see that the revenue in the year 2021 was lower than that of 2020. This was primarily due to the pandemic and the decline in sales associated with the government shutdowns. And the decline in sales led to a lower number for the operating income, which then later down led to a lower net income number. So overall, the whole reason for lower numbers in the year 2021 was due to the pandemic. However, when we look at the margins, in other words, when we compare the gross margin and operating margin over the past few years, we can see that they have been pretty consistent. Next, looking at the dividends per share. Back in 2012, the company paid out about 51.91 yen as dividend. And for the year 2021, they paid out about 62.70 yen as dividend. We can see that Shin-Etsu has been paying consistent dividends over the past 10 years and has been hiking its dividends for majority of the past 10 years. Next, looking at the shares outstanding. Back in 2012, the company had about 1,698 million shares outstanding. And for the trailing 12 months, it had 1,664 million shares outstanding. When we look at the past 10-year trend, we can see that the shares outstanding peaked back in 2018 when it got to about 1,706 million shares outstanding. And ever since then, it appears that the company has been buying back its shares, as the share count has now dropped down to about 1,664 million shares. After that, looking at the book value per share, the book value is what we get when we subtract the company's total liabilities from its total assets. Back in 2013, the company's book value was about $9.37 per share, and for the trailing 12 months, it's about $16.06 per share. Finally, looking at the free cash flow. The free cash flow is what we get when we subtract the capital spending from the company's operating cash flow. Back in 2012, the company's free cash flow was about 15,343 million yen. And for the year 2021, it was about 163,804 million yen. Ideally, we want to see the company's free cash flow to be staying steady or increasing. And we can see that Shin-Etsu's free cash flow over the past 10 years has stayed fairly consistent. I will be using the past 10 years of free cash flows for my expected rate of return calculation, and I will be using the 2021 figure of 163,804 million yen for my discounted free cash flow DCF analysis. Now let's look at the profitability of the company, focusing on the net margin. The net margin is the ratio of the company's bottom line to its top line, so it compares the company's net income to its revenue. Back in 2012, the company's net margin was about 9.61%. And for the year 2021, it was about 19.62%. What this means is every $100 that the company made in sales in the year 2021, by the time it paid for its cost of goods, operating expenses, non-operating expenses, interest on its debt obligations, and taxes, it had about $19.62 left as pure profit. Next, looking at the return on equity. The return on equity is the ratio of the company's net income to its shareholders' equity. Warren Buffett prefers to only invest in securities that have had a return on equity of 8% or greater every year for the past 10 years. Back in 2012, the company's return on equity was about 7%. And for the year 2021, it was about 10.74%. Shin-Etsu's return on equity has been greater than 8% every year since 2018. Next, looking at the return on invested capital. This number gives an idea of how good the management is at allocating the company's capital and getting a return on that investment. Back in 2012, Shin-Etsu's return on invested capital was about 6.79%, and for the year 2021, it was about 10.53%. Shin-Etsu's weighted average cost of capital, also known as the company's hurdle rate, is about 5.4%, and since the company's return on invested capital is greater than its weighted average cost of capital, we can safely say that the management is creating value for its shareholders. Next, looking at the interest coverage. The interest coverage is the ratio of the company's income to its interest obligations. So it gives an idea of how many times can the company pay off its interest obligations using its income in that calendar year. Back in 2012, the company's interest coverage was about 300 times, and for the year 2021, it was about 553 times. Benjamin Graham, the father of value investing, preferred to only invest in securities that had an interest coverage of 5 times or higher. Now let's look at the financial health of the company, focusing on the liquidity ratios. The first item on the list is the current ratio. The current ratio compares the company's current assets to its current liabilities. Ideally, we want to see the company's current ratio to be greater than 1. It's even better if it's greater than 1.5. Back in 2012, the company's current ratio was at 3.80, and for the latest quarter, it's at 5.64. Next, looking at the quick ratio. The quick ratio is similar to the current ratio, except we disregard the inventory component. In other words, quick ratio is equal to current assets minus inventory divided by current liabilities. Ideally, we want to see the company's quick ratio to be greater than 1.0. as that tells us that the company does not have to rely on selling its inventory in order to fulfill its current liabilities. Back in 2012, the company's quick ratio was at 2.40, and for the latest quarter, it's at 4.38. The company's quick and current ratios over the past 10 years indicate that Shin-Etsu was never in a liquidity bind. Next, looking at the financial leverage. Financial leverage is the ratio of the company's total assets to its shareholders' equity. A high financial leverage tells us that more of the company's assets are financed via liabilities. Back in 2012, the company's financial leverage was at 1.24, and for the latest quarter, it's at 1.91. Over the past 10 years, the company's financial leverage has stayed fairly consistent. Finally, looking at the debt-to-equity ratio, this ratio compares the company's total debt to its shareholders' equity. We can see that the company's debt-to-equity ratio for the latest quarter, it's at 0.01, which tells us that the company has minuscule amount of debt compared to the company's equity. Now, let's look at the efficiency ratios, focusing on the day sales outstanding. This number gives an idea of how many days go by from the day the company recognizes its sales to the day it actually receives cash for that service rendered. Back in 2012, the company's day sales outstanding was at 93.15 days, and for the year 2021, it was about 81.61 days. Ideally, we want the company's day sales outstanding number to be staying steady or decreasing. What we do not want to see is a company whose day sales outstanding number is growing rapidly, as that tells us that the company's management is being aggressive with its accounting, as it's trying to recognize its revenue sooner so that it can inflate its income numbers on its income statement. However, in the case of Shin-Etsu, we can see that the day sales outstanding have stayed fairly consistent, so it doesn't appear that the management is playing any financial shenanigans. Next, looking at the day's inventory. This number gives an idea of how many days does Shin-Etsu's products sit in its inventory before they're sold. Back in 2012, the company's products sat in its inventory for about 102.52 days, and for the year 2021, it was about 139.90 days. Over the past few years, the company's day's inventory has slowly been creeping up, which tells us that the company is becoming less efficient with its inventory. Next, looking at the payables period, this number gives an idea of how many days does Shin-Etsu take to pay its suppliers. Back in 2012, the company took about 58.65 days to pay its suppliers, and for the year 2021, they paid about 50 days to pay its suppliers. Over the past 10 years, the company's payables period has stayed fairly consistent. Finally, looking at the inventory turnover, the inventory turnover gives us an idea of how many times does Shin-Etsu's inventory go through its system in a calendar year. Back in 2012, the company's inventory turnover was about 3.56 times, and for the year 2021, it was about 2.60 times. We can see that compared to the previous years, the company's inventory turnover saw a decline in the year 2020 and 2021. This may have been due to the decline in sales, which led to a bloating up of the inventory, leading to a lower numbers for the year 2020 and 2021. Now let's compare the company's current valuation to that of the S&P 500. The S&P 500 is the aggregate of the top 500 companies in the United States. The first item on the list is the price-to-earnings ratio. Shin-Etsu's PE is at 25.6, whereas S&P 500 is at 25.3. Shin-Etsu's price-to-book is at 2.8, whereas S&P 500 is at 4.5. Shin-Etsu's price-to-sales is at 5.2, whereas S&P 500 is at 3.2. Shin-Etsu's price-to-cash flow is at 20.4, whereas S&P 500 is at 18.1. Finally, the dividend yield. Shin-Etsu has a dividend yield of 1.3%, whereas S&P 500 is at 1.4%. We can see that on all these valuation metrics, other than the price-to-book ratio, Shin-Etsu is overvalued when compared to the S&P 500. Hey guys, now let's look at the discounted free cash flow DCF analysis for Shin-Etsu. Over here, I based the company's 2021 free cash flow number that I got from Morningstar, which was actually 163,804 million yen. I converted this number to US dollar using the conversion rate that one US dollar is equal to 110 Japanese yen. So the US dollar equivalence of free cash flow came to about $1,486 million. I'm using an annual growth rate of free cash flow to be 7%. What this means is I expect the company's free cash flow to grow at 7% every year for the next 10 years. I'm using a discount rate of 10%. What this means is I want this investment to give me a 10% return. I'm using a long-term growth rate of 4%. What this means is after the 10-year mark into perpetuity, I expect Shin-Etsu's free cash flow to grow at 4%. Next, looking at the shares outstanding, the company has 1,664 million shares outstanding and has a long-term debt of $144 million. I got this number from the company's balance sheet. After taking all of these inputs into account, we get the company's intrinsic value to be about $35.13 per share. When we compare this intrinsic value to the company's current stock price of about $45.60 per share, we can see that the company's current stock is trading about 1.3 times the company's intrinsic value. The way we calculate this intrinsic value is we look at what the free cash flows would be every year for the next 10 years. We sum up all those free cash flows, which come out to about $12.8 billion. Then we look at what the free cash flows would be after the 10-year mark into perpetuity. We sum all those up to get the intrinsic value to be about $31.87 billion. From this number, we subtract the long-term debt and divide by the shares outstanding to get the intrinsic value per share to be about $19. After that, we add the book value per share. And for the trailing 12 months, the book value was about $16.06 per share. So the final intrinsic value after adding the $16.06 to the $19.07 came to about $35.13 per share. Now, if we disregard the perpetuity component, in other words, if we think that Shin-Etsu is only going to grow for the next 10 years and then it'll cease to exist, then we get the intrinsic value without the perpetuity to be about $7.62 per share. And finally, if we disregard the debt, in other words, if we think that Shin-Etsu is going to grow into perpetuity, so there's no point for the company to even worry about its debt, then we get the intrinsic value without the debt to be about $35.21 per share. Finally, we know that the company's weighted average cost of capital, also known as the company's hurdle rate, is about 5.4%. And if we add a 2% margin of safety on top of that and make our discount rate 7.4%, then we get the intrinsic value to be about $51.01. And in this case, the company's current stock price is actually trading at a discount of about 11% below the company's intrinsic value. Hey guys, now let's look at the expected rate of return calculation for Shin-Etsu. Over here, I based it the past 10 years of free cash flows that I got from Morningstar. All the numbers here are millions of US dollars. The initial numbers were in Japanese yen. However, I divided those numbers by 110 to get the US dollar equivalents, as the current conversion rate is about one US dollar being equal to 110 Japanese yen. This is the yearly free cash flow trend that we get over the past 10 years. We can see the consistency in the company's free cash flows. Next, looking at the future data and predictions, I'm assuming that there's a 30% likelihood that the company's free cash flow will grow at 8%. There's a 55% likelihood that its free cash flow will grow at 6%. A 15% likelihood that its free cash flow will grow at 3%. These are the potential free cash flow rates that we get into the future. After taking into account the numbers of shares outstanding, which is at 1,664 million shares, at the current stock price of about $45.60 per share, we can expect to get an annual return of about 0.4%. What this means is if you were to purchase a share of Shin-Etsu at the current stock price of about $45.60 per share and hold this security through 2080, then we can expect to get an annual return of about 0.4% on this investment. Hey guys, now let's wrap it all up. We briefly went over Shin-Etsu's annual report and saw how the company has six reportable segments. The PVC segment brings in the most amount of revenue out of those six segments. We saw that the company's revenue, operating income, as well as net income over the past 10 years has been trending upwards. However, there was a decline in the company's sales in the fiscal year 2021, which led to lower numbers in the company's revenue, operating income, as well as net income when compared to those numbers in the fiscal year 2020. Next, we saw that Shin-Etsu has been paying consistent dividends over the past 10 years and has also been hiking its dividends for majority of the past 10 years. The company has also been buying back its shares recently. Both these actions of share buybacks and dividend hikes actually indicate that the company's management is shareholder friendly. Shin-Etsu's return on equity has been greater than 8% since 2017, and the company's return on invested capital is greater than its weighted average cost of capital, which tells us that the company's management is creating value for its shareholders. Finally, Shin-Etsu's interest coverage is greater than 5x. Next, we looked at the company's financial and liquidity ratios and saw how the company's current and quick ratios both point out that the company is extremely liquid and has more than enough current assets to fulfill its current liabilities. Shin-Etsu's financial leverage and debt-to-equity ratios point out that the company is not leveraged and has little to no debt on its balance sheet. Next, we saw that the company's efficiency has stayed fairly consistent over the past 10 years, which tells us that the company's management is not playing any financial shenanigans in order to pretty up its financial statements. When we compared Shin-Etsu's current valuation to those of the S&P 500, we saw that on all the valuation metrics other than the price-to-book ratio, Shin-Etsu is overvalued when compared to the S&P 500. Next, we performed the discounted free cash flow DCF analysis and found out that when we use a 10% discount rate, the intrinsic value came to about $35.13 per share. However, when we use a 7.4% discount rate, the intrinsic value came to about $51 per share, which would indicate that the company's current stock is trading about 11% below its intrinsic value. After that, when we looked at the expected rate of return calculation, we found out that if you were to invest in Shin-Etsu at the current stock price of about $45.6 per share and hold the security through 2080, then we can expect to get an annual return of about 0.4% on this investment. Overall, Shin-Etsu has strong fundamentals. The company has little to no debt, which makes the company able to withstand any turbulent times in the economy. And finally, the company has a long roadway of growth ahead. Right now, Shin-Etsu's current stock price is not cheap. However, we run into this dilemma of how much are you willing to overpay for a good business. Superior North has one share of Shin-Etsu in its portfolio. And if Shin-Etsu's stock price drops further, then I will be adding more shares of Shin-Etsu in Superior North's portfolio. Hey guys, that is all I had for you this week. Hopefully you found this video on Shin-Etsu interesting. If you like this content, please do like, share, comment, and subscribe. And if you have any suggestions on which stock I should review next, please leave it in the comment section below. I will greatly appreciate it. Thank you.